This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. Below left, Polish and Ukrainian troops in Khreshchatyk during the Kiev Offensive, 7 May 1920. Top right, Polish Schwarzlose M07, 12 machine gun nest during the Battle of Radzymin, August 1920. Middle, Polish defenses with a machine gun position near Miłosna, in the village of Janki, Battle of Warsaw, August 1920. Bottom left, Russian prisoners on the road between Radzymin and Warsaw after the attack by the Red Army on Warsaw. Bottom right, Polish defensive fighting positions in Belarus during the Battle of Niemen, September 1920. Date 1919-1921. Location: Central and Eastern Europe. Result: Polish victory. Polish forces prevent Soviet occupation of Poland. Soviet forces take control of Ukraine. Peace of Riga. Belligerents. Szymon Petliura. Strength from approximately 50,000 in early 1919 to almost 800,000 in summer 1920. From approximately 50,000 in early 1919 to approximately 738,000 in August 1920. Casualties and losses estimated: 60,000 killed, 80,000 to 157,000 taken prisoner, including rear area personnel. About 47,000 killed, 113,518 wounded, 51,351 taken prisoner. VE Polish-Soviet War. Polish-Soviet War in 1919. Soviet westward offensive of 1918-19. Bereza Kartuska Lita Vilna Minsk. First Berezina Dogovpils. Polish-Soviet War in 1920. Ladizow Koziatyn. Kiev Offensive 1920. Wolodarka Bystrik. First Grodno Borispol Deblin Nasiels Radzymin. Osow, Warsaw, Minsk, Mazowiecki, Sykow, Lwów, Zadwars, Bialystok, Komaro, Dyshitin, Second Niemen. VE Polish-Russian Wars. Muscovite, Lithuanian, Livonian 1605-18. Dmitriad, Smolensk 1654-67. War of the Polish Succession. War of the Bar Confederation 1792. Kosciuszko Uprising. Napoleon's Invasion of Russia. November Uprising. January Uprising. Polish-Soviet 1939. VE Establishment of the Second Polish Republic. Greater Poland 1918-19. Ukraine 1918-19. Polish-Soviet War 1919-21. Czechoslovakia 1919. Szczecin 1919. Upper Silesia 1919-21. Lithuania 1920. VE Theaters of the Russian Civil War. October Revolution. Left-wing uprisings. Allied intervention. Siberia, North Russia. Northern Vega River. Bolshyi Ozerki. Western Finland. Hemisodet. Estonia. Latvia. Lithuania. Southern Ukraine. West Ukraine. Poland. Ossetia. Georgia. Armenia and Azerbaijan. Soviet invasion of Azerbaijan. Tambov. Eastern Yakutia. Central Asian. Basmachi. The Polish-Soviet War. February 1919 to March 1921 was an armed conflict that pitted Soviet Russia and Soviet Ukraine against the Second Polish Republic and the Ukrainian People's Republic over the control of an area equivalent to today's Ukraine and parts of modern-day Belarus. Ultimately, the Soviets, following on from their westward offensive of 1918-19, hoped to fully occupy Poland. Although united under communist leadership, Soviet Russia and Soviet Ukraine were theoretically two separate independent entities, since the Soviet republics did not unite into the Soviet Union until 1922. Poland's chief of state, Józef Piłsudski, felt the time was right to expand Polish borders as far east as feasible, to be followed by a Polish-led Intermarium Federation of East Central European states as a bulwark against the re-emergence of German and Russian imperialism. Lenin, meanwhile, saw Poland as the bridge the Red Army had to cross to assist other communist movements and bring about other European revolutions. By 1919, Polish forces had taken control of much of Western Ukraine, emerging victorious from the Polish-Ukrainian War. The West Ukrainian People's Republic, led by Yevhen Petrushevich, had tried to create a Ukrainian state on territories to which both Poles and Ukrainians laid claim at the same time in the Russian part of Ukraine. Szymon Petliura tried to defend and strengthen the Ukrainian People's Republic, but as the Bolsheviks began to gain the upper hand in the Russian Civil War, they started to advance westward towards the disputed Ukrainian territories, causing Petliura's forces to retreat to Podolia by the end of 1919, a clear front had formed as Petliura decided to ally with Pilsudski. Border skirmishes escalated following Pilsudski's Kiev Offensive in April 1920. The Polish offensive was met by an initially successful Red Army counterattack. The Soviet operation pushed the Polish forces back westward all the way to the Polish capital, Warsaw, while the Directorate of Ukraine fled to Western Europe. Meanwhile, Western fears of Soviet troops arriving at the German frontiers increased the interest of Western powers in the war. In midsummer, the fall of Warsaw seemed certain, but in mid-August, the tide had turned again, as the Polish forces achieved an unexpected and decisive victory at the Battle of Warsaw in the wake of the Polish advance eastward. The Soviets sued for peace and the war ended with a ceasefire in October 1920. A formal peace treaty, the Peace of Riga, was signed on 18 March 1921, dividing the disputed territories between Poland and Soviet Russia. The war largely determined the Soviet-Polish border for the period between the World Wars. Much of the territory allocated to Poland in the Treaty of Riga became part of the Soviet Union after World War II, when Poland's eastern borders were redefined by the Allies in close accordance with the Curzon Line of 1920. Contents 1. Names and dates 2. Prelude 3. Course 3. 1919-311. First Polish-Soviet Conflicts 312. Diplomatic Front, Part 1. 3-2-1920-321. Opposing Forces 3211 Red Army 3212 Polish Forces 3213 Logistics and Plans 322 Kiev Offensive 323 String of Soviet Victories 324 Diplomatic Front, Part 2325 Battle of Warsaw 326 Conclusion 33 Aftermath 4 Historical Assessment 41 List of Battles 5 See also 6 Notes 7 References 8 Further Reading 81 Non-English 811 Polish 812 Russian. 9 External links. Names and dates. The war is known by several names. Polish-Soviet War may be the most common, but is potentially confusing, as Soviet commonly refers to Soviet Russia, not the Soviet Union, which did not officially exist until 31 December 1922. Alternative names include Russo-Polish War of 1919-1921 to distinguish it from earlier Polish-Russian wars, and Polish-Bolshevik War. This second term, or just Bolshevik War, Polish, Wojna Bolshevika, is most common in Polish sources. In some Polish sources it is also referred as the War of 1920, Polish, Wojna 1920 Roku. There is disagreement over the dates of the war. The Encyclopædia Britannica begins its article with the date range 1919-1920, but then states, although there had been hostilities between the two countries during 1919, the conflict began when the Polish head of state Józef Pilsudski formed an alliance with the Ukrainian nationalist leader Szymon Petliura the 21st of April 1920, and their combined forces began to overrun Ukraine, occupying Kiev on 7 May. The Polish Internetowa Encyclopedia PON, as well as Western historians such as Norman Davies, consider 1919 the starting year of the war. The ending date is given as either 1920 or 1921. This confusion stems from the fact that while the ceasefire was put in force in the autumn of 1920, the official treaty ending the war was signed months later, in March 1921. While the events of 1919 can be described as a border conflict, and only in early 1920 did both sides realize they were engaged in all-out war, the conflicts that took place in 1920 were an inevitable escalation of fighting that began in earnest a year earlier. In the end, the events of 1920 were a logical, though unforeseen, consequence of the 1919 Prelude main article, Causes of the Polish-Soviet War. Partitions of Poland in 1795, the colored territories show the extent of the Polish Lithuanian Commonwealth just before the first partition in blue northwest, land absorbed by the Kingdom of Prussia, green south by Austria, and cyan east by the Russian Empire. The war's main territories of contention lie in present-day Ukraine and Belarus. Until the middle of the 14th century they formed part of the medieval state of Kievan Rus. After a period of internecine wars and the Mongolian invasion of 1240, these lands became objects of expansion for the Kingdom of Poland and for the Grand Duchy of Lithuania in the first half of the 14th century, the Grand Duchy of Kiev and land between the Dnieper, Pripyat, and Daugava Western Dvina rivers became part of the Grand Duchy of Lithuania, and in 1352 Poland and Lithuania divided the Kingdom of Galicia-Volhynia between themselves in 1569, in accordance with the terms of the Union of Lublin between Poland and Lithuania. Some of the Ukrainian lands passed to the Polish crown between 1772 and 1795, much of the Eastern Slavic territories became part of the Russian Empire in the course of the partitions of Poland after the Congress of Vienna of 1814-1815, much of the territory of the Duchy of Warsaw Poland transferred into Russian control as World War I ended 1918, the map of Central and Eastern Europe changed drastically. Germany's defeat rendered Berlin's plans for the creation of Eastern European puppet states Mitteleuropa, including one in Poland, obsolete. The Russian Empire collapsed, resulting in the Russian Revolution of 1917 and the Russian Civil War of 1917-1922. Several small nations of the region saw a chance for real independence and seized the opportunity to gain it. Soviet Russia viewed its lost territories as rebellious provinces, vital for its security, but did not have the resources to react swiftly. While the Paris Peace Conference of 1919 had not made a definitive ruling in regard to Poland's eastern border, it issued a provisional boundary in December 1919, the Curzon Line, as an attempt to define the territories that had an indisputably Polish ethnic majority. The conference participants did not feel competent to make a certain judgment on the competing claims. With the success of the Greater Poland Uprising 1918-19, Poland had re-established its statehood for the first time since the 1795 partition, forming the Second Polish Republic. It proceeded to carve out its borders from the territories of its former partitioners. Many of these territories had long been the object of conflict between Russia and Poland. Re-establishment of the Polish state, March 1919. Poland was not alone in its newfound opportunities and troubles. With the collapse of Russian and German occupying authorities, virtually all of Poland's newly independent neighbors began fighting over borders. Romania fought with Hungary over Transylvania, Yugoslavia with Italy over Rijeka, Poland with Czechoslovakia over Cyzin Silesia, with Germany over Poznan, and with Ukrainians over Eastern Galicia. Ukrainians, Belarusians, Lithuanians, Estonians and Latvians fought against each other and against the Russians, who were just as divided. Spreading communist influences resulted in communist revolutions in Munich April-May 1919, in Berlin January 1919, in Budapest March-August 1919 and in Prešov in Slovakia June-July 1919. Winston Churchill commented, "The war of giants has ended, the wars of the pygmies begin." All of these engagements, with the sole exception of the Polish-Soviet War, would prove short-lived. The Polish-Soviet War likely happened more by accident than design, as it seems unlikely that anyone in Soviet Russia or in the new Second Republic of Poland would have deliberately planned a major foreign war. Poland, its territory a major battleground during the First World War, lacked political stability. It had won the difficult conflict with the West Ukrainian National Republic by July 1919 but had already become embroiled in new conflicts with Germany, the Silesian uprisings of 1919-1921, and with Czechoslovakia January 1919. Revolutionary Russia, meanwhile, focused on thwarting counter-revolution and the intervention by the Allied powers 1918-1925. While the first clashes between Polish and Soviet forces occurred in February 1919, it would take almost a year before both sides realized that they had become engaged in a full-scale war. Soviet leader Vladimir Lenin, as early as late 1919, the leader of Russia's new Bolshevik government, Vladimir Lenin, inspired by the Red Army's Civil War victories over White Russian anti-communist forces and their Western allies, began to see the future of the revolution with greater optimism. The Bolsheviks proclaimed the need for the dictatorship of the proletariat, and agitated for a worldwide communist community. They had an avowed intent to link the revolution in Russia with an expected revolution in Germany and to assist other communist movements in Western Europe. Poland was the geographical bridge that the Red Army would have to cross to provide direct physical support in the West. Lenin aimed to regain control of the territories abandoned by Russia in the Brest-Litovsk Treaty of March 1918, to infiltrate the borderlands, to set up Soviet governments there as well as in Poland, and to reach Germany, where he expected a socialist revolution to break out. He believed that Soviet Russia could not survive without the support of a socialist Germany. By the end of the summer of 1919, the Soviets had taken over most of Ukraine, driving the Ukrainian Directorate from Kiev in February 1919. They also set up a Lithuanian-Belarusian Republic, Litbel. This government was very unpopular due to terror and the collection of food and goods for the army officially. However, the Soviet government denied charges of trying to invade Europe as Polish-Soviet fighting progressed, particularly around the time Poland's Kiev Offensive had been repelled in June 1920. The Soviet policy makers, including Lenin, increasingly saw the war as a real opportunity to spread the revolution westwards. Historian Richard Pipes noted that before the Kiev Offensive, the Soviets had prepared for their own strike against Poland. Polish leader Józef Piłsudski. Before the start of the Polish-Soviet War, Polish politics were strongly influenced by Chief of State Naczelnik Państwa Józef Piłsudski. Piłsudski wanted to break up the Russian Empire and to set up a Polish-led Mijimors Federation of independent states. Poland, Lithuania, Ukraine, and other Central and East European countries emerging out of crumbling empires after the First World War. He hoped that this new union would become a counterweight to any potential imperialist intentions on the part of Russia or of Germany. Piłsudski argued, there can be no independent Poland without an independent Ukraine, but he may have been more interested in Ukraine being split from Russia than in Ukrainians' welfare. He did not hesitate to use military force to expand the Polish borders to Galicia and Volhynia, crushing a Ukrainian attempt at self-determination in the disputed territories east of the southern Bug River, which contained a significant Polish minority, who made up the majority of the population in cities like Lwów, in contrast to the Ukrainian majority in the countryside. Speaking of Poland's future frontiers, Piłsudski said, all that we can gain in the west depends on the Entente, on the extent to which it may wish to squeeze Germany, while in the east, there are doors that open and close, and it depends on who forces them open and how far. In the chaos to the east, the Polish forces set out to expand there as much as feasible. On the other hand, Poland had no intention of joining the Western intervention in the Russian Civil War or of conquering Russia itself. Piłsudski also said, closed within the boundaries of the 16th century, cut off from the Black Sea and Baltic Sea, deprived of land and mineral wealth of the south and southeast, Russia could easily move into the status of second-grade power. Poland, as the largest and strongest of new states, could easily establish a sphere of influence stretching from Finland to the Caucasus before the Polish-Soviet War. Jan Kowalewski, a polyglot and amateur cryptologist, managed to break the codes and ciphers of the Army of the West Ukrainian People's Republic and of General Anton Denikin's White Russian forces during his service in the Polish-Ukrainian War. As a result, in July 1919 he was transferred to Warsaw, where he became chief of the Polish General Staff's Radio Intelligence Department. By early September he had gathered a group of mathematicians from Warsaw University and Lwów University, most notably, founders of the Polish School of Mathematics, Stanisław Lesniewski, Stefan Mazurkiewicz and Wacław Sierpiński, who succeeded in breaking Soviet-Russian ciphers. As well, decoded information presented to Piłsudski showed that Soviet peace proposals with Poland in 1919 were false, and that in reality the Soviets had prepared for a new offensive against Poland and had concentrated military forces in Barasa near the Polish border. Piłsudski decided to ignore the Soviet proposals, to sign an alliance with Szymon Petliura of the Ukrainian People's Republic, and to prepare the Kiev offensive during the war. Polish decryption of Red Army radio messages made it possible to use small Polish military forces efficiently against the Soviet-Russian forces and to win many individual battles, most importantly the 1920 Battle of Warsaw. Course 1919 Main Article, Polish-Soviet War in 1919. First Polish-Soviet Conflicts. Polish propaganda poster showing Polish cavalry and an ape-like Bolshevik soldier, with the caption, "Smash the Bolshevik." The first serious armed conflict of the war took place around 14 February to 16 February, near the towns of Manevichi and Biroza in Belarus. By late February the Soviet westward advance had come to a halt. Both Polish and Soviet forces had also been engaging the Ukrainian forces, and active fighting was going on in the territories of the Baltic countries, CF Estonian War of Independence, Latvian War of Independence, Lithuanian Wars of Independence, Central and Eastern Europe. In December 1919, in early March 1919, Polish units started an offensive, crossing the Niemen River, taking Pinsk, and reaching the outskirts of Lita. Both the Soviet and Polish advances began around the same time. In April, Polish forces started a major offensive on 16 April, resulting in increasing numbers of troops arriving in the area. That month the Red Army had captured Grodno, but was soon pushed out by a Polish counter-offensive. Unable to accomplish its objectives and facing strengthening offensives from the White forces, the Red Army withdrew from its positions and reorganized. Soon the Polish-Soviet War would begin in earnest. Polish forces continued a steady eastern advance. They took Lita on 17 April and Nowogrodzki on 18 April, and recaptured Vilnius on 19 April, driving the Litbel government from their proclaimed capital on 8 August. Polish forces took Minsk, and on 28 of that month they deployed tanks for The first time after heavy fighting, the town of Babruz near the Berezina River was captured by 2 October. Polish forces reached the Dagawa River and secured the region from Desna to Daugavpils Dynburg. Polish success continued until early 1920. Sporadic battles erupted between Polish forces and the Red Army, but the latter was preoccupied with the White counter-revolutionary forces and was steadily retreating on the entire Western front line, from Latvia in the north to Ukraine in the south in early summer 1919. The White movement had gained the initiative, and its forces under the command of Anton Denikin were marching on Moscow. Pilsudski was aware that the Soviets were not friends of independent Poland, and considered war with Soviet Russia inevitable. He viewed their westward advance as a major issue, but also thought that he could get a better deal for Poland from the Bolsheviks than their Russian Civil War contenders, as the White Russians, representatives of the old Russian Empire, partitioner of Poland, were willing to accept only limited independence of Poland, likely in the borders similar to that of Congress Poland, and clearly objected to Ukrainian independence, crucial for Pilsudski's Mijimors. While the Bolsheviks did proclaim the partitions null and void, Pilsudski thus speculated that Poland would be better off with the Bolsheviks, alienated from the Western powers, than with the restored Russian Empire by his refusal to join the attack on Lenin's struggling government, ignoring the strong pressure. From the Entente, Pilsudski had possibly saved the Bolshevik government in summer-fall 1919, although a full-scale attack by the Poles in support of Denikin was not possible. He later wrote that in case of a white victory, in the East Poland could only gain the ethnic border, at best the Curzon line. At the same time, Lenin offered Poles the territories of Minsk, Jytomyr, Khmelnytsky, in what was described as mini Brest. Polish military leader Kazimierz Sosnkowski wrote that the territorial proposals of the Bolsheviks were much better than what the Poles had wanted to achieve. Diplomatic Front, Part 1. In 1919, several unsuccessful attempts at peace negotiations were made by various Polish and Russian factions. In the meantime, Polish-Lithuanian relations worsened as Polish politicians found it hard to accept the Lithuanians' demands for certain territories, especially the city of Vilnius, which had a Polish ethnic majority but was regarded by Lithuanians as their historical capital. Polish negotiators made better progress with the Latvian provisional government, and in late 1919 and early 1920 Polish and Latvian forces were conducting joint operations, including the Battle of Daugavpils, against Soviet Russia. Polish General Antoni Listowski left and Ukrainian leader Simon Petlura, allied with Poland. The Warsaw Treaty, an agreement with the exiled Ukrainian nationalist leader Simon Petlura signed on 21 April 1920, was the main Polish diplomatic success. Petlura, who formally represented the government of the Ukrainian People's Republic by then de facto defeated by Bolsheviks, along with some Ukrainian forces, fled to Poland, where he found asylum. His control extended only to a sliver of land near the Polish border. In such conditions, there was little difficulty convincing Petlura to join an alliance with Poland, despite recent conflict between the two nations that had been settled in favor of Poland by concluding an agreement with Pilsudski. Petlura accepted the Polish territorial gains in western Ukraine and the future Polish-Ukrainian border along the Zbruch River in exchange. He was promised independence for Ukraine and Polish military assistance in reinstalling his government in Kiev. For Pilsudski, this alliance gave his campaign for the Mijimors Federation the legitimacy of joint international effort, secured part of the Polish eastward border, and laid a foundation for a Polish-dominated Ukrainian state between Russia and Poland. For Petlura, this was the final chance to preserve the statehood and, at least, the theoretical independence of the Ukrainian heart lands, even while accepting the loss of West Ukrainian lands to Poland. Yet both of them were opposed at home. Pilsudski faced stiff opposition from Dmowski's National Democrats, who opposed Ukrainian independence. Petlura, in turn, was criticized by many Ukrainian politicians for entering a pact with the Poles and giving up on Western Ukraine. The alliance with Petlura did result in 15,000 pro-Polish allied Ukrainian troops at the beginning of the campaign, increasing to 35,000 through recruitment and desertion from the Soviet side during the war. This would, in the end, provide insufficient support for the alliance's aspirations. 1920 Main Article, Polish-Soviet War in 1920. Opposing forces. Norman Davies notes that estimating strength of the opposing sides is difficult. Even generals often had incomplete reports of their own forces. Red Army. By early 1920, the Red Army had been very successful against the White Armies they defeated. Denikin and sign peace treaties with Latvia and Estonia, the Polish front became their most important war theater, and a plurality of Soviet resources and forces were diverted to it in January 1920. The Red Army began concentrating a 700,000-strong force near the Berezina River and on Belarus by the time Poles launched their Kiev Offensive. The Red Southwestern Front had about 82,847 soldiers, including 28,568 frontline troops. The Poles had some numerical superiority, estimated from 12,000 to 52,000 personnel by the time of the Soviet counter-offensive in mid-1920. The situation had been reversed. The Soviets numbered about 790,000, at least 50,000 more than the Poles. Tukhachevsky estimated that he had 160,000 combat-ready soldiers. Pilsudski estimated his enemy's forces at 200,000 to 220,000 during 1920. Red Army personnel numbered 402,000 at the Western Front and 355,000 for the Southwest Front in Galicia. Grigory Krivosheev gives similar numbers, with 382,000 personnel for the Western Front and 283,000 personnel for the Southwestern Front. Norman Davies shows the growth of Red Army forces on the Polish front in early 1922. 1 January 1920 to 4 infantry divisions, 1 cavalry brigade the 1st of February 1920 to 5 infantry divisions, 5 cavalry brigades the 1st of March 1920 to 8 infantry divisions, 4 cavalry brigades the 1st of April 1920 to 14 infantry divisions, 3 cavalry brigades the 15th of April 1920 to 16 infantry divisions, 3 cavalry brigades the 25th of April 1920 to 20 infantry divisions, 5 cavalry brigades. Among the commanders leading the Red Army in the coming offensive were Leon Trotsky, Tukhachevsky, new commander of the Western Front, Alexander Yegorov, new commander of the Southwestern Front, and the future Soviet ruler Joseph Stalin. Polish forces. Further information: Polish Soviet War, Polish Order of Battle. The Polish army was made up of soldiers who had formerly served in the various partitioning empires, supported by some international volunteers, such as the Kosciuszko Squadron. Boris Savinkov was at the head of an army of 20,000 to 30,000 largely Russian POWs, and was accompanied by Dmitry Mareszkowski and Zenaida Gippius. The Polish forces grew from approximately 100,000 in 1918 to over 500,000 in early 1920. In August 1920, the Polish army had reached a total strength of 737,767 soldiers. Half of that was on the front line. Given Soviet losses, there was rough numerical parity between the two armies, and by the time of the Battle of Warsaw, Poles might have even had a slight advantage in numbers and logistics. Among the major formations on the Polish side was the 1st Polish Army. Logistics and plans. Logistics, nonetheless, were very bad for both armies, supported by whatever equipment was left over from World War I or could be captured. The Polish army, for example, employed guns made in 5 countries, and rifles manufactured in 6, each using different ammunition. The Soviets had many military depots at their disposal, left by withdrawing German armies in 1918-19, and modern French armaments captured in great numbers from the White Russians and the Allied expeditionary forces in the Russian Civil War. Still, they suffered a shortage of arms. Both the Red Army and the Polish forces were grossly under-equipped by Western standards. The Soviet High Command planned a new offensive in late April, May. Since March 1919, Polish intelligence was aware that the Soviets had prepared for a new offensive, and the Polish High Command decided to launch their own offensive before their opponents. The plan for Operation Kiev was to beat the Red Army on Poland's southern flank and install a Polish-friendly Petlura government in Ukraine. Kiev Offensive. Main article: Kiev Offensive 1920. Until April, the Polish forces had been slowly but steadily advancing eastward. The new Latvian government requested and obtained Polish help in capturing Daugavpils. The city fell after heavy fighting at the Battle of Daugavpils in January and was handed over to the Latvians by March. Polish forces had driven a wedge between Soviet forces to the north. Belarusia and South Ukraine. Polish Kiev offensive at its height. June 1920. On the 24th of April, Poland began its main offensive, Operation Kiev. Its stated goal was the creation of an independent Ukraine that would become part of Pilsudski's project of a Mijimors Federation. Poland's forces were assisted by 15,000 Ukrainian soldiers under Simon Petlura, representing the Ukrainian People's Republic. On the 26th of April, in his Call to the People of Ukraine, Pilsudski told his audience that the Polish army would only stay as long as necessary until a legal Ukrainian government took control over its own territory. Despite this, many Ukrainians were just as anti-Polish as anti-Bolshevik, and resented the Polish advance. The Polish Third Army easily won border clashes with the Red Army in Ukraine, but the Reds withdrew with minimal losses subsequently. The combined Polish-Ukrainian forces entered an abandoned Kiev on 7 May, encountering only token resistance. Polish Brigade 14 operating from Kiev airfield. This Polish military thrust was met with Red Army counterattacks on 29 May. Polish forces in the area, preparing for an offensive towards Jelobin, managed to hold their ground, but were unable to start their own planned offensive in the north. Polish forces had fared much worse. The Polish First Army was defeated and forced to retreat, pursued by the Russian 15th Army, which recaptured territories between the western Dvina and Berezina rivers. Polish forces attempted to take advantage of the exposed flanks of the attackers, but the enveloping forces failed to stop the Soviet advance at the end of May. The front had stabilized near the small river Auta, and Soviet forces began preparing for the next push on 24 May 1920. The Polish forces in the south were engaged for the first time by Semyon Budyonny's famous 1st Cavalry Army Konarmia. Repeated attacks by Budyonny's Cossack cavalry broke the Polish-Ukrainian front on 5 June. The Soviets then deployed mobile cavalry units to disrupt the Polish rearguard, targeting communications and logistics by 10 June. Polish armies were in retreat along the entire front on 13 June. The Polish army, along with Petlura's Ukrainian troops, abandoned Kiev to the Red Army. String of Soviet victories. Polish fighters of the 7th Kosciuszko Squadron. Soviet offensive successes. Early August 1920. Polish propaganda poster text reads, "To arms. Save the fatherland. Remember well our future fate." On 30 May 1920, General Alexei Brusilov, the last Tsarist commander-in-chief, published in Pravda an appeal entitled "To all former officers, wherever they might be," encouraging them to forgive past grievances and to join the Red Army. Brusilov considered it as a patriotic duty of all Russian officers to join hands with the Bolshevik government, that in his opinion was defending Russia against foreign invaders. Lenin also spotted the use of Russian patriotism. Thus, the Central Committee appealed to the respected citizens of Russia to defend the Soviet Republic against a Polish usurpation. The historians recalled the Polish invasions of the early 17th century American volunteer pilots, Marion C. Cooper and Cedric Fauntleroy, fought in the Kosciuszko Squadron of the Polish Air Force. Russia's counter-offensive was indeed boosted by Brusilov's engagement. 14,000 officers and over 100,000 deserters enlisted in or returned to the Red Army, and thousands of civilian volunteers contributed to the effort. The commander of the Polish Third Army in Ukraine, General Edward Ryde Smigley, decided to break through the Soviet line toward the northwest. Polish forces in Ukraine managed to withdraw relatively unscathed, but were unable to support the Northern Front and reinforce the defenses at the Auta River for the decisive battle that was soon to take place there. Due to insufficient forces, Poland's 200-mile-long front was manned by a thin line of 120,000 troops backed by some 460 artillery pieces with no strategic reserves. This approach to holding ground harked back to the World War I practice of establishing a fortified line of defense. It had shown some merit on the Western Front, saturated with troops, machine guns, and artillery. Poland's Eastern Front, however, was weakly manned, supported with inadequate artillery, and had almost no fortifications against the Polish line. The Red Army gathered its Northwest Front led by the young General Mikhail Tukhachevsky. Their numbers exceeded 108,000 infantry and 11,000 cavalry, supported by 722 artillery pieces and 2,913 machine guns. The Soviets at some crucial places outnumbered the Poles 4-1. Tukhachevsky launched his offensive on 4 July, along the Smolensk-Brest-Litovsk axis, crossing the Auta and Berezina rivers. The Northern 3rd Cavalry Corps, led by Gay B.Z. Hishkian Gay Dmitrievich Gay, G.A.J. Chan, were to envelop Polish forces from the north, moving near the Lithuanian and Prussian border, both of these belonging to nations hostile to Poland. The 4th, 15th, and 3rd armies were to push west, supported from the south by the 16th Army and Mosier Group. For 3 days the outcome of the battle hung in the balance, but Soviet numerical superiority proved decisive, and by 7 July Polish forces were in full retreat along the entire front. However, due to the stubborn defense by Polish units, Tukhachevsky's plan to break through the front and push the defenders southwest into the Pinsk marshes failed. Polish resistance was offered again on a line of German trenches, a line of heavy World War I field fortifications that presented an opportunity to stem the Red Army offensive. However, the Polish troops were insufficient in number. Soviet forces found a weakly defended part of the front and broke through. Gaj Chan and Lithuanian forces captured Vilnius on 14 July, forcing the Poles into retreat again in Galicia to the south. General Semyon Budyonny's cavalry advanced far into the Polish rear, capturing Brody and approaching Lwów and Zamosk in early July. It became clear to the Poles that the Soviets' objectives were not limited to pushing their borders westwards. Poland's very independence was at stake. Soviet forces moved forward at the remarkable rate of 20 miles 32. For only 1 week after crossing the Narew River on 2 August, the Soviet Northwest Front was only 60 miles 97. Warsaw. The Polish political scene had begun to unravel in panic, with the government of Leopold Skulski resigning in early June. Meanwhile, the Soviet leadership's confidence soared. In a telegram, Lenin exclaimed, "We must direct all our attention to preparing and strengthening the Western Front. A new slogan must be announced, prepare for war against Poland." Soviet communist theorist Nikolai Bukharin, writer for the newspaper Pravda, wished for the resources to carry the campaign beyond Warsaw, right up to London and Paris. General Tukhachevsky's order of the day, 2 July 1920, read, "To the west. Over the corpse of White Poland lies the road to worldwide conflagration. March on Vilno, Minsk, Warsaw, and onward to Berlin over the corpse of Poland." The increasing hope of certain victory, however, gave rise to political intrigues between Soviet commanders. General Józef Haller touching the flag and his Blue Army by order of the Soviet Communist Party, a Polish puppet government, the Provisional Polish Revolutionary Committee Polish, Tymczasowy Komitet Rewolucyjny Polski, TKRP, had been formed on the 28th of July in Bialystok to organize administration of the Polish territories captured by the Red Army. The TKRP had very little support from the ethnic Polish population and recruited its supporters mostly from the ranks of minorities, primarily Jews. At the height of the Polish-Soviet conflict, Jews had been subject to anti-Semitic violence by Polish forces, who considered Jews a potential threat, and who often accused Jews as being the masterminds of Russian Bolshevism. During the Battle of Warsaw, the Polish government interned all Jewish volunteers and sent Jewish volunteer officers to an internment camp. Britain's Prime Minister, David Lloyd George, pressed Poland to make peace on Soviet terms and refused any assistance to Poland that would alienate the whites in the Russian Civil War. In July 1920, Britain announced it would send huge quantities of World War I surplus military supplies to Poland, but a threatened general strike by the Trades Union Congress, who objected to British support of White Poland, ensured that none of the weapons destined for Poland left British ports. David Lloyd George had never been enthusiastic about supporting the Poles, and had been pressured by his more right-wing cabinet members such as Lord Curzon and Winston Churchill into offering the supplies in early July 1920. Prime Minister Władysław Grabski traveled to the Spa conference in Belgium to request assistance. The Allied representatives were largely unsympathetic. Grabski signed an agreement containing several terms, that Polish forces withdraw to the Curzon Line, which the Allies had published in December 1919, delineating Poland's ethnographic frontier, that it participate in a subsequent peace conference, and that the questions of sovereignty over Vilnius, Eastern Galicia, Cieszyn Silesia, and Danzig be remanded to the Allies. Ambiguous promises of Allied support were made in exchange. Polish troops in Kiev on 11 July 1920, the government of Great Britain sent a telegram to the Soviets, signed by Curzon, which has been described as a de facto ultimatum. It requested that the Soviets halt their offensive at the Curzon Line and accept it as a temporary border with Poland, until a permanent border could be established in negotiations in case of Soviet refusal. The British threatened to assist Poland with all the means available, which, in reality, were limited by the internal political situation in the United Kingdom. On 17 July, the Bolsheviks refused and made a counter-offer to negotiate a peace treaty directly with Poland. The British responded by threatening to cut off the ongoing trade negotiations if the Soviets conducted further offensives against Poland. These threats were ignored. Citation needed. On 6 August 1920, the British Labour Party published a pamphlet stating that British workers would never take part in the war as Poland's allies, and labour unions blocked supplies to the British Expeditionary Force assisting Russian whites in Arkhangelsk. French socialists, in their newspaper La Humanité, declared, "Not a man, not a sou, not a shell for reactionary and capitalist Poland. Long live the Russian Revolution." Long live the Workmen's International. Poland also suffered setbacks due to sabotage and delays in deliveries of war supplies, when workers in Czechoslovakia and Germany refused to transit such materials to Poland. On 6 August, the Polish government issued an appeal to the world, disputing charges of imperialism, stressing Poland's determination for self-determination and the dangers of Bolshevik invasion of Europe. Poland's neighbor Lithuania had been engaged in serious disputes with Poland over the city of Vilnius and the borderlands surrounding Szczecin and Sławki. A 1919 Polish attempt to take control over the entire nation by a coup had additionally disrupted their relationship. The Soviet and Lithuanian governments signed the Soviet-Lithuanian Treaty of 1920 on 12 July. This treaty recognized Vilnius as part of Lithuania. The treaty contained a secret clause allowing Soviet forces unrestricted movement within Soviet-recognized Lithuanian territory during any Soviet war with Poland. This clause would lead to questions regarding the issue of Lithuanian neutrality in the ongoing Polish-Soviet war. The Lithuanians also provided the Soviets with logistical support. Despite Lithuanian support, the Soviets did not transfer Vilnius to the Lithuanians till just before the city was recaptured by the Polish forces in late August. Instead, up till that time the Soviets encouraged their own pro-communist Lithuanian government, Litbel, and were planning a pro-communist coup in Lithuania. The simmering conflict between Poland and Lithuania culminated in the Polish-Lithuanian War in August 1920. Polish allies were few. France, continuing its policy of countering Bolshevism now that the Whites in Russia proper had been almost completely defeated, sent a 400-strong advisory group to Poland's aid in 1919. It consisted mostly of French officers, although it also included a few British advisers led by Lieutenant General Sir Adrian Carton de Wiart. The French officers included a future President of France, Charles de Gaulle. During the war he won Poland's highest military decoration, the Virtuti Militari. In addition to the Allied advisors, France also facilitated the transit to Poland from France of the Blue Army in 1919, troops mostly of Polish origin, plus some international volunteers. Formerly under French command in World War I, the army was commanded by the Polish general, Józef Haller. Hungary offered to send a 30,000 cavalry corps to Poland's aid, but the Czechoslovakian government refused to allow them through, as there was a demilitarized zone on the borders after the Czechoslovak-Hungarian War that had ended only a few months before. Some trains with weapon supplies from Hungary did, however, arrive in Poland in mid-1920. The Allied mission was expanded by some advisers becoming the Interallied mission to Poland. They included French diplomat Jean-Jules Jusserand, Maxime Weygand, Chief of Staff to Marshal Ferdinand Foch, Supreme Commander of the Victorious Entente, and British diplomat Lord Edgar Vincent d'Abernon. The newest members of the mission achieved little. Indeed, the crucial Battle of Warsaw was fought and won by the Poles before the mission could return and make its report. Nonetheless, for many years, a myth persisted that it was the timely arrival of Allied forces that had saved Poland, a myth in which Weygand occupied the central role. Nonetheless, Polish-French cooperation would continue and French weaponry, including infantry armament, artillery and Renault FT tanks, were shipped to Poland to reinforce its military. Eventually, on 21 February 1921, France and Poland entered into a formal military alliance, which became an important factor during the subsequent Soviet-Polish negotiations. Battle of Warsaw. Main article, Battle of Warsaw 1920. On 10 August 1920, Soviet Cossack units under the command of Gaik Bz Hishkian crossed the Vistula River, planning to take Warsaw from the west, while the main attack came from the east. On 13 August, an initial Soviet attack was repulsed. The Polish First Army resisted a direct assault on Warsaw as well as stopping the assault at Radzymin. The Soviet Western Front commander, Mikhail Tukhachevsky, felt certain that all was going according to his plan. However, Polish military intelligence had decrypted the Red Army's radio messages, and Tukhachevsky was actually falling into a trap set by Pilsudski and his chief of staff, Tadeusz Rozdowski. The Soviet advance across the Vistula River in the north was moving into an operational vacuum, as there were no sizable Polish forces in the area. On the other hand, south of Warsaw, where the fate of the war was about to be decided, Tukhachevsky had left only token forces to guard the vital link between the Soviet Northwest and Southwest fronts. Another factor that influenced the outcome of the war was the effective neutralization of Budyonny's 1st Cavalry Army, much feared by Pilsudski and other Polish commanders. In the battles around Lwów, at Tukhachevsky's insistence, the Soviet High Command had ordered the 1st Cavalry Army to march north toward Warsaw and Lublin. However, Budyonny disobeyed obeyed the order due to a grudge between Tukhachevsky and Yegorov, commander of the Southwest Front. Joseph Stalin, then chief political commissar of the Southwest Front, was engaged at Lwów, about 200